And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera Blind. I'm the RPG chick. Of course, we're just hanging out here where we stopped off last time, and in the bloom, the vast interior. Before I do anything else, though, I want to check out this Merecaster. I remember what the thing looks like. That can't be it, no. That's the floral Merecaster. Kaleidoscopic Merecaster. I've seen both of those before. That's the Meriden's Key. This is the twisted metal one that... I don't know. What's it say again? I'm not sure if we've been in this one. Yeah. Not too sure. So that's the... We've got circulating... Sorry guys, just wanna... We've been in that one. They all look like strange things, right? Astronomical Merecaster, right? We found this somewhere here. Filled with ingenious clockwork mechanisms, this cobalt orrery depicts a solar system far different from your own. Tiny planets orbit and rotate soundlessly and endlessly, the pattern of their paths no doubt revealing alien destinies and prodigies to be puzzled over by learned beings in some distant unknown place. Here, it is merely a novelty, though one that invites contemplation. Can we get in this one? As soon as you place this device in the palm of your hand, the stately dance of the clockwork planets mounted upon it becomes a frantic spinning reel. In the heart of the thing, a contemplative hum grows, as though the machine itself were studying the path of the planets above it. Listening, you hear shadows of words within that sound, speaking of the mirror within this device. Inspect. You study the whirl of the planets in your palm. Your eyes might be deceiving you, but it does seem as though some of the orbs are slightly transparent, and that tinier planets are orbiting within them. And such as it is, from the planetary to the subatomic level. It's very similar. Planets are rotating around a sun, as the sun is a nucleus and a molecular, if you shrink everything down, very similar. Enter? Whose dish? Blue. Once you had 24 words for all its hues and shades. Minotaurs to glaives, capes, and courtesans' eyes. Now the sky is just blue. The ground is stone. The man before you, fat. Now all is vague and drab, like... The memorialist sees you've stopped, and he halts as well. Let's have a rest, then, he says, passing you a bottle of fortified water as he catches his breath. You know a word for that, too. They drink... This drink they brew in the Valley of Dead Heroes. Gone. We aren't far from his cenotaph. The fat man wipes his brow. Deep in your pocket, your hand feels for the round tin that holds the worms. Your fingers clutch it tight, and as they do, they brush a piece of paper. Are you his shadow? The memorialist asks abruptly. Kalagat Anvor, I mean. The one you came to see. Without waiting for a response, he barrels forward. We thought he'd cast his shadows among his own kind. We reasoned that with the Tabaht gone, his line was lost forever. He stops and flushes more deeply. Then, hastily, with a sigh... A sign? A sign, adds? But shadows fall where they will, as they will. Kalaget Anvor, Tabaht. Shadows. They flit around the edges of your mind, escaping your grasp, but the worms, they are well within reach. Shall we continue, Pilgrim? The memorialist asked to break the silence. One more short hike will do it. Your body is ready, but your mind is not. What's the paper in the pocket? Yeah, let's look at this. You slip the crisp, neatly folded sheet from your pocket and carefully open it. I will want the worms, but I will be strong. I will wonder what I have lost, but they will only rob me further. I will endure, and I will build the tower of my intellect anew. Kalaget Anvor will furnish the material. The mind link, not the worms, will be my tool. The mind link. A dead-eyed trader from Haref sold it for the last of your once great heap of prizes and bounties. Now it's slung from your belt, a hideous mask with a synth tube hanging off of it like some Sathoshi tentacle. Examine the tin in your pocket. The tin is old and unremarkable, scuffed and dented but sturdy enough. It opens easily. Inside is a clump of bristly worms, blind and thin, barely moving. Your fingers itch and tremble. Your nostrils flare. You no longer know their name, but you know exactly how to use them. Careful not to spill the precious contents, you close the tin and slide it back into your pocket. Snort a worm? What? Kalaget Anvor? Shadows? Tabaht? The memorialist regards you skeptically, as he expects it to be the butt of a joke. As he looks at your eyes, however, he softens. We live in a world of darkness, Pilgrim, and each of us is just a shadow of one of the great heroes buried here in this valley. But there's a light that shines behind this world. To know it, we shadows must measure ourselves against the heroes who cast us, and thus learn from the light that lives beyond. He takes a swig from his canteen. I thought you set out on this pilgrimage to visit the tomb of Kalaget Anvor because you were his shadow, that you wanted to stand before him and find enlightenment. Am I wrong? Are you his shadow or not? I don't know. Yes, I'm his shadow. The memorialist smiles. It's a rare honor to join shadow and hero, and a joy for those of us who shepherd pilgrims through the valley. He gestures to the hilltop toward which you've been hiking. Just over that rise is the monument. As for his tomb, you said that the cenotaph would lead the way. I can't see how, but for the famous puzzle breaker of Sagus Cliffs, I'm sure it will be simple. Your mind might still be clouded, but at least now the form of things has become clearer. Okay. I just am very curious why the hell he would snort a worm, so let's see what happens. Snorting a worm, guys. That's what it sounds like. Gripping a grub between two fingers, you slip it into your nostril and breathe as deeply as you can. The worm works with you, eager to reach its meal. Ooh! You feel it squirm the last stretch, and then pain like a knife stabs your brain. And you know the worm is feeding, eating gray matter and pissing neurostimulants, letting your mind reconquer the vast territories it has lost. This can't be really good for you. Nematodes? That's what they're called. Not worms. And cerulean. That's the sky's color. Not blue. The rush of understanding overwhelms you. You read the world's hidden, unwritten words. Devise stratagems and unravel mysteries. Okay, so what made us smarter or brighter or we can think better or something? Then it's gone. Again, words and thoughts slip from you as you frantically struggle to hold on to what you can. The worm's short gift has been squandered. They must be used carefully, sparingly. With a shaking hand, you twist the tin shut and slip it back into your pocket. Okay, carefully, sparingly. Okay, so let's not snort another one then. Let's go. I want to see the cenotaph. As you follow the memorialist up the crumbling path, he carries on about a time when all the roads in the valley were as well paved as the streets of Sagus Cliffs. Then, reaching the hill crest, he falls into reverential silence. When you catch up, you see the sight that awed him, even for the thousandth time. A clutch of exquisite monuments, ranging from vast to miniature, from abstract to eerily lifelike. The memorialist points to one of them, a many-sided slab of black stone, and gestures for you to follow. This must be the cenotaph of Caligat Anvor, Tabaht General, and would-be World Conqueror. Up close, the cenotaph is not so unremarkable. Its faces are adorned with gruesome, stylized reliefs, depicting the Tabaht and their dragolith mounts trampling the corpses of their foes. Neat geometric glyphs encircle the panels. Like the images themselves, they are embossed rather than engraved. The memorialist clears his throat. Of course, Caligat Anvor isn't here. Like the other heroes, his body's in one of the cells in the catacombs beneath us. He nods at the monument. This is its own sort of shadow. All memorials are. As your guide mumbles something about the difference between expression, impression, and reality, your attention returns to the cenotaph itself. Because every time we have an option to snort another worm. Examine the images. No doubt some historian could tell the tale behind each panel. What doomed race the Tabaht annihilated here? What grand battle was waged here? But to you, they're just an ugly blur that tugs at shameful memories without ever quite dragging them to the surface. This is not the knowledge you came for. On one side of the cenotaph, there's something else, an obscene picture. Crudely etched rather than raised, its edges scorched black. The memorialist clears his throat awkwardly. A graffito from just after the Tabaht were beaten, carved with a plasma torch by a bitter nano. The visual pun on Black 3 must be obvious. Sadly, we can't possibly fix the damage. Study the glyphs. What seemed at first individual glyphs are far more complex. Smaller symbols assembled into larger patterns, linked into chains, twined and twisted into knots. Never a tangle or ramble, it is more mathematical or scientific notation than language. Running your fingers across the glyphs, you see that they shine briefly under your touch, then fade. Perhaps there is a formula here to be solved, a structure, a higher, hidden order to be found. Perhaps here you could catch glimmers of the Tabaht's military mastery. But the sieve of your mind holds nothing, and any secrets slip right through. As you struggle to decipher the symbols, the memorialist hurries over. This one means war, he says, illuminating a cluster repeated endlessly on the cenotaph. This one, death. He picks out others and shows how the ideogram for soldier weaves into warband, which can in turn mesh into column or army. Excitement grows in his voice as he leads you to another panel, and shows you the unique markings that compose the pattern for our underspine. A high council, we think, or God. He notes what seems to be a structure to the writing, a pattern within the pattern. Could it be a puzzle to open the way to Caligat Anvor? He asks, expectantly. You have no answer for his hopes. Alright, let's study the basin first before we look at it again. Or snort worms. Carved into the cenotaph's plinth is a wide, shallow bowl, perfectly smooth, perfectly ovoid. In its center is a small drain that runs into the monument. Around its rim is a geometric pattern, simple and composed of a single recurrent shape. You recognize the symbol, blood. Of course, it could be nothing else. Your guide keeps back from the basin as you examine it and shares no thoughts. Spill blood. Alright, let's take another look at the glyphs, then. War, blood, battle, death. Those symbols are graven in your mind just as they are on the cenotaph, but you can squeeze no more meaning from memory than you can from the stone. Try to find the correct sequence of glyphs. You trick yourself into thinking that you can crack whatever code the stone holds, but neither logic nor luck makes any headway. The glyphs shine and fade, but nothing happens. Given the endless combinations, not even the persistence you had of old could break through this lock. Once again, you guess a possible series of glyphs that might provoke some reaction from the cenotaph. If there is a key, you do not find it. Sacrifice the memorialist? Oh my god. Let's try snorting another worm. Let's try that. Your brain races with the speed brought on by the worms. Piss. And through your thoughts run the Tabaht symbols, spinning, twisting, combining, and dividing. There's a meaning here, tangled amid the knotted glyphs, and your mind is unraveling it, surely. But not fast enough. Your thoughts become painfully, shamefully slow, and the puzzle you felt so close to breaking now seems impregnable. Another worm. Just one more, and your mind, honed like a sword, will slice through the skeins. You're sure of it. So sure of it, you find yourself sniffing in anticipation, a predator on the scent. Alright, let's spill some of the blood in the basin, let's try that. And then, if not, then another worm. I'm not going to sacrifice the memorialist. Beneath your guide's worried gaze, you nick your wrist and drizzle some blood into the bowl. Nothing comes of it. Whatever flows through your veins will not slake the stone's thirst. Did I lose, strength? Might that way? I don't even know. Snort another worm. Another worm in the Cenotaph's puzzle crumbles before you. It seems so simple now, so obvious. A prayer woven within the story. A prayer of submission to the truth of war and blood and death. You need but touch the glyphs, and the way will open before you. Cool. Your fingers race across the glyphs, which now do not fade as you progress. Rather, with each touch, they grow brighter and brighter. You can hear the excited gasp from your guide as you reach the last side of the cenotaph. With a flourish, you press the final symbols. The skein ends in war, of course. Blue light pours forth from the cenotaph, forming a kind of shimmering portal. Through it, you see hints of a room. His tomb, whispers the memorialist. A smile sneaks onto your face as you see the way before you. Examine the portal. Some sort of room, bathed in blue light, lies beyond the portal. The tomb of Kalagat Anvor, it would seem. The knowledge you seek awaits within. Let's step through. You step toward the wavering energy field and stare at the blue-tinged tomb beyond, the resting place of Kalagat Anvor. The memorialist remains at a respectful distance. May you find enlightenment beside your hero, pilgrim. Tarrying no longer, you plunge through. The tomb's walls are bare stone, as is its floor. In fact, the tomb is empty except for the sarcophagus that lies at its center, a crystalline Numenera that hums with an ancient indefatigable energy. Bathed in the portal's light, the room seems almost underwater, a sensation heightened by the air's unnatural weight. So is this like the chamber that we're trying to fix at the beginning of the game? We never did, by the way. At least I don't think so. We never saw it again. Study the sarcophagus. The sarcophagus is divided into three parts, a wide bier, an elongated pentagonal coffin, and a curved lens-like lid. The bier is decorated with familiar glyphs. You recognize war and death and purity among them. But these designs hold little interest. They are just catchwords, and they will teach you nothing of the Tabaht genius. The coffin, for its part, is a single hunk of milky aquamarine. Its lid is less opaque, and through it you can see the corpse's silhouette. Most importantly, you notice a simple locking mechanism holding the two together. Opening the sarcophagus would be a straightforward matter. Well, then let's do so. A few twists of the coffin's cylindrical locks, and the lid rises up with a hiss of icy, age-old air. As the mist clears, you can at last see the face of Kalagat Anvor. You feel nothing at the sight of him, never having known the terror of his triumvirate. His inhuman features are slightly mummified, but well-preserved. His ebon tabard is faded with time that even the sarcophagus could not keep at bay. But it is his head that matters, not his clothes. His head and its brain, and the insight sheathed within, an edge keen enough to cut through the tangle of your own failures. Use the mind link on a Tabaht corpse. Once you slip the helmet over your face, you can't see and can barely breathe. Oh, those are it's me breathing. Trapped in the massed, damp darkness, you fumble for the socket at the base of the corpse's skull. At last you find it, and, still struggling, try to bring the conduit tube into contact. Suddenly the darkness explodes with light, the nebulous patchwork glow of your own mind, and, beyond it, the glorious mandala formed by the thoughts of Kalagat Anvor. A mote emerges from that pattern, and a confused voice whispers, "You are not the underspine." Almost instantly, the geometry of his mind transforms into a star fortress from whose bastions dagger-like shapes stream forth. "You will not taint my thoughts," the Tabaht voice rumbles as his fleet soars towards you. There's no time to try and reason with him, if that would ever be possible. It seems madness that he fears you could pollute his mind, when merely fending off his force shall be at the limits of your worm-wasted will. Mount your own attack. You came in to hold on your mind, and perhaps this is the way to do so. Fend him off. You came here to rebuild your mind, not to offer it up for Tabaht pillaging, or let him in. Mount your own attack. You came here to hone your mind, and perhaps this is the way to do so. Whatever weapons your mind once wielded have long since been worn blunt by the worms, and what remains cannot be by any means match the will of Kalagat Anvor. He knocks aside your sally, and then, with wild violence, hacks apart your memories and fears, doubts and despair, tattering the fabric of yourself. You watch helplessly, and with failing comprehension, as blue-black blotches spread across your mind. In the end, it all means nothing to the masked fool crouched beside a corpse, drooling, moaning, and weeping without knowing why. Oh, that was pretty sudden. Was there a good option of this? Was there a better option? Can I go back in? Which one was it again? Twisted metal. I don't remember what it looked like. It's a problem. Astronomical. Yeah, see, I don't know what that's an image of. No way to access it again. Well, pretty short episode, but I'm not sure. I think it's a good idea to end off here and make the next episode being, we're going to go into... What's it called again? Not the trade post. Lost Anchorage, next episode, guys. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.